Today, I want to discuss and present you some results about the behavior of two-layer neural networks when they're trained with gradient descent. So this will be a talk about the mathematical analysis of such training dynamics. And I will present a few results that I have obtained with Francis Back on this topic. So I'm happy because Gaël has presented, we will be in a similar setting as Gaël has presented at the beginning of his talk, which is the setting of supervised machine learning. So we have a couple of random variables, X and Y, where X will live in R to the D, D can be typically large, and Y is just a response variable. And given N IID samples, we want to build a function H, so that was the function called F in Gaël's talk, which predicts the correct output given input X, which has not necessarily been observed previously. So there are many ways to build such functions H, some such predictors. But in this talk, we will focus on why two-layer ReLU neural networks. So these are a specific class of models, which are vanilla two-layer neural networks, which are typically graphically represented as follows. But for two-layer neural networks, we have this specific structure. They can be written as a sum of M simple functions, where M is the width of the hidden layer. And each of the simple function phi is a function that takes the input x and also some parameters wj, which are the weights of this, we call it the weights of the hidden unit of the neuron corresponding to the index j. And this simple function for rectified linear unit nonlinearity is given as follows. It's the composition of an affine transformation of the input parameterized by a weight vector A in R to the D plus one. Then there is a nonlinearity, which is just the positive part. And then there is a multiplication by a scalar, which is called B, and it's just a real number. So for each of these simple functions, it will be parameterized by AB, the weights of the hidden units. And the goal of the learning algorithm will be to select the suitable choices of weights for all the hidden units of the neural network so that we achieve this prediction task. So there are many other functions which could be considered as a phi, but in this talk, I will focus on the rectified linear unit presented here for the sake of clarity and also because there are some specific properties of this function that I will use in the theoretical results. And in particular, one such property is that phi is too homogeneous in the parameters. What does that mean? It means that if I multiply the parameters of a hidden unit by some scalar R, then the output is multiplied by R to the squared. Why? Because both A and B will be multiplied and the max nonlinearity, ReLU nonlinearity is also homogeneous. All right. So that's the model, and now the goal is to learn this weight wj, and typically we do this via empirical risk minimization. So this means that we choose some loss. So here I will assume it's convex and smooth. You can think of the logistic loss or the square loss. And then we minimize a function of all the parameters of the neural network, fm, which is the sum of the empirical risk, so the sum of the losses observed on the training set. And optionally, we can have also a regularization term with some regularization parameter lambda, which is either non-zero or positive. So I have a question. Oh, no, okay, no, that was an answer to a question to the previous talk. All right. Well, I'm watching the conversation. So if you have a question, you can ask it directly there. So the regularization in the setting I will consider today is just the squared norm of all the parameters in the neural network. Okay, and it's optional. We'll consider both the case, which is regularized or not. So this function fm, which is typically the one we minimize when we train a neural network, it is notoriously non-convex, and it's hard to find a minimizer of it. But in practice, we often just run gradient-based algorithms, such as stochastic gradient descent, and we observe satisfactory results. So that's what I would like to understand better today. So we consider the following training dynamics. We initialize all the weights of the neural networks independently by following some distribution on the space of parameters mu zero. So here, this is a distribution with finite second moment. which characterize the distribution of all the weights of the neural networks at initialization. And then from this initialization, we just follow the gradient flow of this objective function. So this is just the continuous time counterpart of gradient-based training algorithms such as stochastic gradient descent or gradient descent. We consider this continuous time dynamics just for the sake of simplicity, because in this talk, I will present only non-quantitative results. But of course, in practice, you should discretize this training algorithm. So let us look at a specific example to see what I'm talking about. So this is a very, really the type of dynamic we are interested in. Here, I will show a video that shows the training dynamics here in the space of parameters, where each point represents the position of the parameters of a neuron of the neural network. I plot this specifically, and the color depends on the sign of the output weight. And here, this is the corresponding prediction function in predictor space. So we will train for a classification task where the goal is to separate the pluses and the minuses. In black, this is the decision boundary. And let us see how this gradient descent dynamics evolves in time. So that's the dynamics I've presented previously. So we see that there are some complicated phenomena at play, but in the end, there are some interesting phenomena also. First, we see that although we had a lot of neurons at initialization, in the end, they have collapsed into just a few clusters. Okay, so that's something we'd like to understand. And in the predictor space, this corresponds to a predictor which is rather simple. This is the decision boundary is polynomial, is polygonal. Okay, so that's a form of simplicity. And here, what I've trained is simply a two-layer neural network with the logistic loss without regularization. So we'll see that there is some kind of implicit regularization at play just due to the fact that we have trained with gradient descent. So this is something, this is the end goal of my talk, is to understand what is this implicit regularization. But more generally, beyond this very specific setting of the video, we want to understand the performance of the predictor learned by these two-layer neural networks, which means the predictor corresponding to the weights after training. All right. So that will be the question of this talk. I will just give briefly a few motivations. So first, of course, the goal is to understand two-layer neural networks. They are an important class of model. In my opinion, they are just the natural next theoretical step after studying linear models, for which we understand rather well theoretically. And we see that there are a lot of difficulties in understanding theoretically these two-layer neural networks, but still we can make progress. We can understand the role of the initialization, the choice of loss, and so on and so on. And more generally, I think these are a good model to understand the phenomenon of representation learning via gradient descent. Because if we were to study more complex models, such as deeper neural networks, so far the analysis is too complicated. We are not able to capture this phenomenon of representation learning. And so that's why we gradually study more complex and more complex models. So here, two-layer neural networks is an important intermediate step towards understanding more precisely deep learning models. So this talk will be divided into three parts. First, I will present the infinite width limit, which is our theoretical tool to push the analysis further, the analysis of these two-layer neural networks further. And then I will study what happens when we regularize the objective, which means that this lambda is non-zero. And then finally, I will present what happens in the unregularized case, when lambda equals zero, which is the setting of the video I've shown previously. So let's jump to the first part, and I will present a global convergence result. So as I've said, the first theoretical tool that we will use is to study the neural network in the limit where its width, so the parameter m, goes to plus infinity. And there is a natural way to reparameterize these models in a way that is insensitive to the width. We will simply use a distribution, a probability distribution on the space of parameters. And now this sum that we had, so let me go back to a previous slide, the sum that was defining our model here, okay, we'll just replace it by an integral, okay, against some distribution mu. So that's what we are doing here. And now the neural network is parameterized by a probability distribution, and we recover a two-layer neural network when mu is an empirical distribution with m atoms. So now that we have changed this parameterization, we can define the corresponding objective function on the space of probability measures, which is the same as before, except that we have changed our parameterization. So we have the empirical risk and potentially a regularization term, which now just becomes the second moment of the distribution mu, which represents the distribution of neurons of our two-layer neural network. So the first result that we can derive using this change of point of view is to say that it actually makes sense to talk about the training dynamics of a neural network in the infinite width limit. What do I mean by that? So let us define this quantity, this distribution mu t m, to be the time-dependent probability distribution that corresponds to the training dynamics of a finite width neural network. So I just take the all the parameters of my neurons. I define the empirical distribution of those parameters. So this is the cloud of points that we have seen in the video. This is a time-dependent probability distribution. The first result that we can show is that it will converge as the width goes to plus infinity to some dynamics, again, in the space of probability distribution, which I will call mu t. So there are some technical assumptions for this result to hold, but in today, I don't want to focus on the technicalities. And so I will not mention the technical conditions and the subtleties, to focus on the main ideas. So what this first result tells us is that there is some kind of ideal object, this mu t, time-dependent probability distribution, which describes well the dynamics of training of a two-layer neural networks, at least when the width is large. And we know that when the width actually goes to plus infinity, this will be exactly this dynamics. So instead of studying this complicated dynamic with m finite, we'll from now on only focus on mu t, this idealized dynamics, which captures well the behavior of two-layer neural networks. And let's see what we can say about this idealized dynamics. The first result that I'm going to present is the global convergence result. It says the following: if at initialization, the distribution is, so first, uniform on the sphere for the input weights, okay, so the input weights Aj are distributed uniformly on the sphere, and the output weights are uniform on minus 1, 1, so just plus 1 or minus 1 with equal probability. So this is just a specific example to fix ideas, but there are more initialization, in particular Gaussian initializations, could be allowed for this theorem. Then, if this training dynamics in the infinite width limit mu t converges weakly to some distribution mu infinity, then the limit is a global minimizer of the objective function f. So here, this result is non-trivial because the objective function f, let me remind you that it is non-convex. And in particular, we can show that there exists some stationary point of the training dynamics which are not global minimizers. So we need a condition on the initialization in order to avoid all these spurious stationary points. And that's where the initialization comes into play. In fact, the key assumption that we need to make to prove these results is that mu zero is really diverse. So that's why we have this uniform distribution on the sphere as an example. We need a diversity at initialization to escape all the bad stationary points. Okay, so that's the main insight. But now what does it tell us about the predictor that we have learned? This is just, we know that we have learned a global minimizer, but what does that mean to be a global minimizer of the objective function f? So of course, it will depend on our choice of loss of objective function, whether there is a regularization or not, and on the properties of the data. So I will present a few settings in this talk, a few implications. So the first case is when lambda is non-zero, when we have regularized our empirical risk. And I can say this is purely a statistical question because we have learned the minimizer of a regularized empirical risk problem. And so we can control the statistical properties of the estimator we have reached. But then there's another interesting case, which is the one I've shown in the video, is when we do not regularize the empirical risk, lambda equals zero, then we need to understand better the training dynamics in order to talk about the performance of the predictor. Why? Because neural networks of this type, they are universal approximators. This means that we could interpolates between the training data points in any way and still find a zero empirical risk. So we need to understand which of all these global minimizers the training dynamics has picked in order to talk about the generalization properties, how the predictor will behave outside of the training samples. And that will be the subject of my third part, where we'll need to go back to the training dynamics to understand where which of these global minimizers has been chosen. Okay, just a small comment is that we can also cover the case of the expected risk or the population risk in this theorem, which leads to other types of insights. And the last comment is that this result is purely non-quantitative. In fact, it's still an open question to find settings where we can make this result quantitative, both in terms of width and in terms of training time. So far, it's purely asymptotic in all sense. So let me show you an illustration of this global convergence. So here we are in parameter space. There is one less dimension as the video was previously, but otherwise these are the same conventions. And we are minimizing the expected risk in a synthetic setting where the training, the inputs are Gaussian and the outputs are generated by a neural network with five neurons. So the goal will be to recover the parameters of these five neurons with our neural networks. And this is how the training dynamics evolve. So here I've initialized on a small sphere around zero. And we see that in the end of training, after a complicated dynamics, all the neurons align with the direction of the teachers, which means that we have converged to a global minimizer. And here I've put 100 neurons to recover five neurons. And you could observe that if you have just five neurons in your neural network, you typically do not convert to the global minimizer. You need over-parameterization. You need more neurons that are needed. And our result tells that when the number of neurons go to plus infinity, this behavior is guaranteed in some sense. All right. So now I will jump to the regularized case to understand what is the predictor that we have learned when we have minimized the regularized empirical risk with our infinitely wide two-layer neural networks. So to understand what we have learned, we can define the following norm on the space of predictors, which is called either the variation norm or sometimes the Baron norm. I will call it F1 in this talk today. It is natural, given the regularization we have introduced. So it's defined as follows. You take a function h from RD2R, some predictor, and you try to decompose it to write it as a two-layer neural network parameterized by some measure mu. And then over all these compositions, you find the one with the smallest second moment, so that the measure mu has the smallest second moment. And this defines the norm on the space of predictors. In fact, you can rewrite this norm using the true homogeneity of phi as follows. You try now to decompose H over rectified linear units of this form parameterized by A, where A now is just a vector on the sphere and nu is a signed measure on the sphere. So we have just changed a little bit the representation, but now if we decompose H as follows, this norm corresponds to finding this decomposition with the smallest total variation norm. So you can think of it as a infinite dimensional generalization of the L1 norm. So there is a sparsifying effect in this norm. We will try to find an expression of H which uses as few neurons as possible. So there is this sparsifying effect in this norm. Okay, so that's the F1 norm. And now what we can trivially say, given the fact that this was the regularization term in our objective, is that if mu star is a global minimizer of the objective function f, then the corresponding predictor minimizes the regularized empirical risk problem with this F1 norm regularization. Okay, so far, I've just rewrote the objective function in predictor space. And so we know that in the context of the previous theorem, we will converge to a predictor that minimizes this problem. But to better understand the properties of this predictor, we can compare it with a different norm, which is the one that we would obtain if we now fix the weights of the hidden units, so the input weights, to be the uniform distribution on the sphere. So this is the predictor that we will obtain if we train the two-layer neural networks, but not We do not train both layers. We only train the output layer. So in terms of code, this just means commenting out one line of code, the one that updates the hidden weights. But we will see that it leads to a very different predictors. So let me define this set S of distributions which have the marginal uniform on the sphere for the input weights, which just means that we fix the input weights to their initial value at initialization. And this defines a different norm on the space of predictors, which is given as follows. We write H, we decompose it as a two-layer neural networks with the hidden weights to be uniform on the sphere. And we, over all these decompositions, we try to find the one where the output weights have the smallest L2 norm. So this is really what I described. We run the same algorithm, but we comment out the line that the line of code that updates the input weights. So this defines a different norm on the space of predictors, which can be shown to be the norm associated to a reproducible kernel Hilbert space. All right. So now if we only train the output layer of the neural networks, again, we can say that we have converged to the minimizer of the regularized empirical risk problem with this F2 norm regularization. So we have these two norms, F1 and F2, whether we train both layers or just the output layer of the two-layer neural network. So let me comment a little bit on these two norms. So first, here is an illustration of what we obtain for a simple regression task in two dimensions, where the pluses are the crosses and the minus one labels are the circles. Okay. Here I've trained both layers, so we converge to the F1 norm regularized empirical risk predictor, minimizer predictor. Okay, here I have lambda strictly larger than zero, there is regularization. And here, this is the same training, but I fix the input layer to the initial value. And so this will be the predictor with F2 norm regularization. So a few comments on these two types of regularization. First, in terms of statistical prior. This F2 norm regularization, in a sense, it can be shown to correspond to some kind of isotropic smoothness prior on the function that we try to predict in regression tasks. This means that we will be good at learning functions which are smooth in all directions and isotropically, and extremely smooth in high dimension, but otherwise it will be very difficult to learn functions with this type of regularization. In contrast, with this F1 regularization, we can have adaptivity to anisotropic regularity, which means that we can have a function which is not smooth in a small subspace and smooth in all other directions, and F1 we will still be able to efficiently learn such functions. So I mean, I'm being very rough to go fast, but all these results can be made precise. And now on the optimization aspect, learning with this F2 norm regularization, it's easy. In fact, you can show that there are algorithms with a guaranteed convergence speed because it's a convex problem. We are learning in the RKHS, and all this is well understood, while learning in F1 is much more difficult. We only have these asymptotic results that I've presented previously, that if we train our infinitely wide two-layer neural networks, in the end, it will converge to this solution, but there is no quantitative guarantee. And in fact, we know that there are some computationally hard problems which are included in learning functions with small F1 norm. So this is much more difficult on the optimization aspect. That's the main comparison between F1 and F2. And so neural networks actually behave like neural networks when they have this type of regularization, this anisotropic smoothness, because here, they have this feature learning capability. It means that they learn what is the useful directions in the data, which are useful to make the correct prediction task, the correct prediction. All right, so now I will jump to the last part. I think I have 5 or 10 more minutes, which deals with the unregularized case, which means now, we do not have weight decay, this regularization term with lambda strictly larger than zero. And we want to understand what is the function that we have learned as before. So I will focus for this talk on one specific example, although the analysis can be carried in other settings, but we have different conclusions every time, so I will focus on a specific one, which is a classification task. So the output, the y variable is in -1, 1. And at test time, we are interested, the prediction we make is the sign of the predictor that we have learned. So in particular, we do not care about the magnitude of h, only its sign matter. Okay. I stress that we consider the unregularized case, lambda equals 0. And we will focus on a specific type of losses, those with an exponential tail. So here I have a small graphical representation of the various losses. And we consider losses which have this type of exponential tail. So this includes logistic loss or the exponential loss. And what's important here is that you see that if you have the correct prediction, then this type of losses, they will motivate you to increase the norm of your predictor so as to still decrease the loss. So in fact, the minimizer at infinity for such losses, and this will be very important in our analysis. But before talking about neural network, I want to give the result that inspired us to give the result for the result I will present, which is by this set of authors, and it deals with linear predictors. So just for this slide, we forget about neural network and we consider predictors, which are simple linear predictor as follows. So the parameter W is just a vector in RD. And we consider a linearly separable training set, which means that there exists a vector W such that H has the correct sign on all the training sets. Okay. So since there is such a vector W, I can always increase its norm and decrease the empirical risk because of this exponential tail. So in particular, the first thing we can show is that for any initialization, the vector of the gradient flow or the gradient descent, this can be also shown, will diverge to plus infinity in norm. So the question is, towards which direction will it diverge? And in fact, we can show that if we take the normalized gradient flow, so just the direction of the predictor, it converges to a L2 max margin classifier. This means that over all vectors W with the L2 norm smaller than one, this is the one with the largest confidence in its prediction. If the confidence is the worst confidence over all the training sets, it can be represented as follows. Okay, so let me just show you a quick illustration of this result. So now we are, I show linearly separable training sets, and the parameter is now just one vector in RD. And when I run a gradient descent with the logistic loss, okay, I converge to the max margin classifier. Here to have a nicer video, I have used the radial scale so that the unit sphere is at infinity. I have applied a hyperbolic tangent to the radial direction so that the fact that this particle does not move anymore, it means that we are diverging to infinity but at a fixed direction. And so this is the max margin classifier where this gradient descent dynamics has led us. And of course, this is really specific to the way we have trained the neural network, the model, because all the classifiers which perfectly classify the data can lead us to zero training loss. But the training dynamics really selects a specific one, which is this max margin classifier. So now let us go back to two-layer neural networks. And let me present the corresponding results in our setting. So as before, we consider an initialization which is uniform on the sphere for the input weights and uniform on -1, 1 for the output weights as before. And we do not need to assume anymore that the training set is linearly separable because two-layer neural networks are universal approximators. So we just need that if we observe twice the same input, then the corresponding labels are the same. That's all we need to assume on the training set. And then there are various technical conditions, which I will not detail today. But under these conditions, we can show, again, that the predictor will diverge in norm to plus infinity. But if I normalize it, in particular by its F1 norm, the predictor corresponding to our training dynamics of a two-layer neural network, it will converge to a F1 max margin classifier. This means that over all prediction function with F1 norm smaller than one, this will be, we will converge to the one with the largest confidence in its prediction. So we have somehow a similar behavior, and it's really specific to the structure of two-layer relu neural networks. I won't talk about the proof, but this result is really specific to the structure of this model. We can also show that if we fix the hidden layer, as I've shown in the second part, then we can we will converge to a F2 max margin classifier, which is just the same definition, but with F2 norm regularization. All right. So what does it look like? Let me show you an example of the training dynamics. Now, this is the same setting, a classification task. Here, I train only the output layer, so we expect to converge to a F2 max margin classifier. And here, this is training both layers, so we will converge to a F1 max margin classifier. These are just training dynamics of why two-layer relu neural networks. And we indeed observe this type of behavior. So here, we converge to a classifier with a smooth decision boundary. And this is something that we can expect from the F2 regularization. We can actually understand why it has a certain degree of smoothness. While here, we converge to a predictor, which is polygonal, which has a polygonal decision boundary. It is made only of a few relu units. And this is the sparsifying effect of this F1 norm that I've presented previously. So I started at 20. Okay, so I will maybe leave more time to questions and skip the following of this talk. I will just present a last slide and no more theoretical results, which show the advantage of having this max margin, this F1 max margin classifier. So I've mentioned previously that this F1 regularization was able to be efficient in settings where there is a lot of anisotropy in the task at hand. So let me show you a synthetic example where this is the case, and we observe this phenomenon. So this is a two-class classification task in dimension 15. And the data is distributed as follows on the first two coordinates, so some clusters with pluses and minuses. And all the other remaining 13 coordinates are uniform at random and are not useful to do the prediction. Okay. So with this setting, I train a wide two-layer relu neural networks. Either I train both layers, so this is in blue, or just the output layer. And we see that with 500 samples, when I train both layers, I almost have perfect generalization performance, which means I actually understood the structure of this this data set. This is this F1 max margin classifier, while if I train only the output layer, this is this F2 regularization. We see that after 500 samples, we are still far from understanding the structure. We make a mistake on 1/4 of all the samples. So the performance is much worse with this F2 max margin classifier. So here, this is really the effect of this adaptivity of two-layer neural networks that we observe in this data. And in fact, we have statistical results that show and that guarantee this type of behavior, but I will not present this result. I will directly jump to the conclusion to leave some time for questions. So there are various ways to extend this work. So first, in what I've presented, there are various open questions. Of course, everything I've presented was qualitative in terms of training dynamics. And so important open questions are to make all these results quantitative when it comes to learning functions with this F1 type regularization. So how fast is the convergence? How many neurons are needed? We need to make these results non-asymptotic. And then there are two directions of extension for this line of work, either by making the model more general. So for instance, to go and study deeper neural networks with more layers. So in that case, we will expect weaker results, but they will be interesting to understand how deep networks, they build their internal representation of the data using gradient descent. And also we can make the model more specific or simpler to analyze. And in particular, we can study linear least squares and understand the implicit regularization of gradient descent on simple problems like linear least squares. So there is a lot of work that is going on in this direction. So here I'm talking about linear least squares, but parameterized in a non-linear way. Okay. And there is a lot of work in this direction, but still many aspects are missing, in particular, fine quantitative results in this setting are missing. So that's another interesting line for future research. And these are the papers on which this talk is based. And I thank you for your attention. I think I've left a few minutes for questions.
So I have one small question. In the regularized part, could you explain us how you calibrate in practice the parameter lambda?
Yeah, so... okay, so this type of results, of theoretical results, they are typically obtained with the constraint problem, yes, where we minimize the empirical risk over F1 ball or F2 ball.
Yes.
In practice, if you want to have the same adaptivity or same statistical property, the main tool is cross-validation.
Yeah, okay.
That's the standard way, yeah, there's no...
Okay, so far you don't have a theoretical choice of lambda, I mean, yes.
No, and it's even if when we have, even in the simplest settings of, say, linear least squares, when we have a theoretical choice for lambda, it depends on things that we do not necessarily know about the data. Yeah. So in practice, you still use cross-validation. So, I mean, to me, that's the general way to go. I can extend a little bit. So the theoretical analysis in the regularized setting, it can tell us about something about the choice of lambda. So in particular, we can know how lambda will scale as a function of the number of training samples. But this will be a function of the smoothness or the properties, functional properties of the function we try to learn. So in particular, we can say that if the function we try to learn has a certain regularity, a number of bounded derivatives, and we know that the best choice for lambda will be to make it decrease with a certain exponent in n. So we can have such a type of results, which are interesting on the statistical aspect, but in practice, still we need to resort to cross-validation.
Okay, thank you. Est-ce qu'il y a d'autres, éventuellement d'autres questions pour Benaïk? Maybe just a very small one before the coffee break. Maybe could you give us some hints about how to infer from a two-layer neural networks to a deeper one where the big problem would occur?
Yeah, so the main difficulty is that for two-layer neural networks, we have this representation as a sum of functions with parameters which are, so here the parameter wj is not shared with other functions, let's say. So we have this separable structure of the predictor, it's just the sum of simple functions. If we have deeper neural networks, there will be cross connections in the hidden layers, and we cannot write the function as a sum of simple functions like that. So in particular, we cannot write in the infinite width limit the predictor as so here, this separable structure allows us to write the predictor in the infinite width limit as a linear function of a probability measure. Okay, but this is not possible anymore for deeper neural networks. So there is all the theory breaks completely, and so there are many attempts to generalize this type of approaches to deeper neural networks. But so far, it's not clear what is the best and the most suitable one.
So thank you again for this very interesting talk, Lenaïk.